Okay, I have been convinced that we probably should not do the very graphic presentation on Islam and women. So we'll go to Sharia finance, and that will probably finish this, because you really have to know how far into our financial system Islam has penetrated and the people that are responsible for it. Use your imagination about what goes on. I gave you a kind of a hint about how women are treated. Women are treated under Islam as property. If they're disobedient, they can be beaten, honor killings, all the rest of that stuff. You can read that on your own. Okay, once again, my buddy Ronald Reagan, you are entitled to your own opinion, but you're not entitled to your own facts. So we're going to talk about financial jihad. If you recall, forgot about that.
You should hear that.
Sounds like a. Never mind.
Why don't you play
this
your phone?
Was what Osama bin Laden wanted to do when he looked at the Twin Towers and he looked at the World Trade Centers and he said, "This is where it all happens. This
Absolutely.
Is where the economic collapse of America is going to
happen." You betcha. Exactly.
And Osama bin Laden could have been killed 4 times.
Before that.
So, yeah.
Exactly.
And this is one of the reasons that we now know that Obama gave the go-ahead to do it, because it would have been really politically bad, since we knew where the guy was, not to do it.
So, 3 times before they could do it.
Anyway, this is where basically I come from. I don't know why we are so tolerant of a group of people that are so intolerant of us. Somebody's got to stand up and say, you know, that's enough. We're not going to take it anymore. It's kind of like Peter Finch in the movie Network when he hangs out the window and he says, "I'm mad as hell and I'm not going to take it anymore." This is basically what the rest of us need to do. I love this cartoon. You have to start connecting the dots. What happens in our media, and I'm not talking about Fox, but I'm talking about NBC, CBS, MS, LSD, and whatever Mark Levin calls it. The problem is we get sound bites. They don't say, you know, what happened today is related to what happened last week. Connect the dots. Very important, because otherwise you have no clue how things relate to one another. Again, we talked about the showers at Auschwitz, the foundation of Sharia law, the basic Islamic belief. It's a circular argument. The Quran is the word of God because it says it is. I had to write my own book. Islam sees the world again as an open-ended conflict, cannot peacefully coexist. And then we get to people who say, "You're an Islamophobe." Well, wait a minute. That's a paranoid fear that is irrational. There is no such thing as Islamophobia. A phobia is an irrational fear, whereas fear of Islam as a clear and present danger is a totally rational reaction by any infidel. They want to cut your head off. They want to crucify you. Doors 1, 2, and 3. The prime directive is to spread Islam by any means whatsoever. We're back to the religious concept of lies and deception. Taqiyya in Arabic, the doctrine of jihad, and the doctrine of jihad includes, as we saw in the beginning this morning, jihad not only with your weapons, but with your wealth. Okay? Sharia law is unconstitutional. They now have blasphemy laws in Dearborn, Michigan, and in Massachusetts, Michigan, Oklahoma, South Carolina, Wyoming, and Pennsylvania. Don't stand on the street corner with a big sign saying Islam is bad. You will be arrested. You are creating a public nuisance. We talked about Sharia law being all-encompassing. Now we're going to look at the financial aspects of it. Again, we're back to the Muslim Brotherhood Jihad for America, part of the Holy Land Foundation, May 22nd, 1991. We got the various groups that are in here. This was the roadmap. This whole thing is on my website. So what you have here is you have what they need to do economically. They have to set up an Islamic bank in the United States. scientific things, to include scientific research centers and stuff like that, an Islamic university, Islamic schools, cultural and intellectual activities and organizations, social organizations, charitable organizations to go and launder money for terrorist groups. This is all in this document. Women's societies up here. Get them involved here. What do we have? Administrative stuff, security apparatus, a legal group. You remember the fatwa from the American Muslim Jurisprudence Association? It's here. Okay, and at the bottom, of course, it says, and success is by God. Then you have all of these different things here in page 18, the 29 groups that were unindicted co-conspirators. So the Muslim Brotherhood credo, which is very important, is Allah is our goal, the Prophet is our guide, the Quran is our constitution, jihad is our way, and death for the glory of Allah is our greatest ambition. It's all right there. You don't need to know much else. That credo is in both of these books. So think about that when you think of the Muslim Students Association, because they have the same credo. The Muslim Students Association held a symposium recently at UCLA last year, and at the end of the rally, 2,000 Muslim students got up and they said, I pledge Allah is my Lord, the Quran is my guide, jihad is my spirit, righteousness is my character, paradise is my goal. I command what is right, forbid what is wrong, and I will fight against oppression and will die to establish Islam. UCLA, you pay for that. It's a public college. 2,000 of these people stood up and pledged this. This is like World War II with the German-American Bund. So, what is the new financial jihad? This is one of the books that is now a monthly magazine put out by Al-Qaeda. It's published by Al-Qaeda. It's on our website. Go under books, go all the way down to the bottom, and I have 6 issues that sit there on the website. This was the very first issue that they put out. It's called Inspire. And inside it goes here, the ruling on dispossessing the disbelievers, that's us, our wealth in Dar al-Harb, in the land of conflict, in the land where Islam is not in control. Inside is a legal opinion, a fatwa by Al-Azhar University, where Obama spoke June 4, 2009, endorsing Al-Qaeda's financial jihad against America. I don't know about you, I have a problem with that. These are some Sharia-compliant U.S. banks.
Citibank?
Oh, wait till I tell you about Citibank. A guy named Al-Walid bin Talal, who is the nephew of the king, the current king of Saudi Arabia, is the 19th richest man in the world, and he made all of his wealth by buying at a discount all of the stock of Citibank in the Middle East. Al-Walid bin Talal is also the guy on 9/12 who tried to give Rudy Giuliani the $10 million check, and Giuliani told him what he could do with it. But we'll get into Al-Walid bin Talal in a minute. The law, when it's applied to finance, says that you can't earn interest. There is no interest allowed under Islam. It's called riba, R-I-B-A. Okay? Muslims cannot earn interest. They can't charge interest. They can't earn interest. It's right there in the Quran, it's right there in the Hadith, and it's right there in Sharia law. So they decide they're going to call it something else because they think they're going to sneak it by Allah. We're going to call this something else and he's not going to see it. Okay? So we're going to sneak it by him. Yes?
That previous slide about the banks, Sharia compliant.
Yes. In other words, these banks, when they make money off of Muslim investments, are committed to skimming 2.5% off the top and sending it to charities in the Middle East that they don't have to disclose to the Securities and Exchange Commission. I'm going to get there. You're like Ben, Glenn Beck says, blood's going to come out of your eyes.
I have an account at Bank of America, and I want to move my money out of there. So could you give me some examples of banks that are Sharia non-compliant?
A local community bank, Mechanics Bank, Bank of the West.
Chase.
No.
Where's Chase on here?
Because I haven't updated it.
How about Wells Fargo?
Oh, yeah, Wells Fargo's now doing it.
What?
Selling Sharia compliant mortgages to Muslims. They're going to go where the money is.
Follow the money.
Follow the money.
2.5% on the
Muslim. 2.5% off of Muslim business by Sharia law and the Quran, zakat. You remember the zakat? We talked about that in the beginning, one of the five pillars of the Islamic faith. It's number four. You've got to pay that tax. And where does that tax go? It goes for jihad. Okay, so here are some of these characters who are involved in the Dow Jones Islamic Index Fund. In Illinois, of course. I took this right off their website. You can go on there yourself. It's all on my website. It's on the sidebar when you first go on the website. It's right there at the very top. So you got guys here like this Bassam Osman, this first guy right there who's a trustee. Guy's been indicted several times for money laundering to terrorist groups. Muzam el-Siddiqui, Orange County. He's the director of the Islamic Society of Orange County, and he's also the guy who sets up all of the protests and everything for the Muslim Students Association at the University of Irvine, UC Irvine. It just keeps on going. Here are some of the current Islamic funds that you find on the Dow Jones. Now remember, Rupert Murdoch owns Dow Jones. He owns the Wall Street Journal, he owns Dow Jones, he owns Fox News, News Corp. The reason Glenn Beck didn't get his contract renewed a year ago was because Murdoch sold a stock interest in News Corp to Al-Waleed bin Talal. Because Murdoch wants to buy into Talal's network in the Middle East. And so bin Talal came back to Murdoch and he said, you know, I'm not really happy with the Glenn Beck program on Fox News. And he's on there with Dave Barton and they're talking about Jefferson and the Muslims and everything else. Didn't like that. So they said, you know, we're not going to renew your contract.
You're saying Fox News is owned by
Rupert Murdoch. Rupert Murdoch owns News Corp. Rupert Murdoch owns News Corp. Fox News is a division of News Corp. He owns the Dow Jones, and he owns the Wall Street Journal.
And why is Fox News the news I want to listen to then? It sounds like they are center right.
You have to notice, if you've been watching Fox News for the last 4 or 5 years,
it's so on.
Exactly. And Hannity is not having conversations and arguments with Imam Chowdhury in England. He doesn't have any Muslims on his program anymore. Wait, I'm getting there. Anybody in here a stockbroker?
I told you never.
What? Oh, okay. Okay. One of the problems that exists with our Security Exchange Commission is that every single one of the Dow Jones Islamic funds that's Sharia compliant is in violation of the Securities Exchange Acts of 1933 and 1934. If you have a 401k or you have a brokerage account or something like that, and your broker wants you to invest in a particular entity like this Dow Jones Islamic Market International Index Fund, and you read the prospectus, you have to get a prospectus, and in every single prospectus under the law that's supposed to be enforced by the Securities Exchange Commission, they have to have a paragraph on risk. They have to tell you what the risk is. Not a single one of these things is legal, because all they do as far as the risk is concerned is they say Islamic Sharia investment risk, the risk of the possibility that the Islamic Sharia restrictions placed on investments and reflected in the principal investment strategies may result in the fund not performing as well as mutual funds not subject to such restrictions. So what are these Sharia restrictions in an investment? You cannot do any business whatsoever with a weapons manufacturer unless the weapons are produced in a Middle Eastern country. So if you want to invest in Iran making the bomb, that is perfectly acceptable in a Muslim investment. Investing in Boeing, Lockheed, Grumman, any one of these companies, can't do it. It's not Sharia compliant. You can't invest in Oscar Mayer wieners, okay? Because they have pig meat, okay? Pork. So any pork products, can't invest in those companies. You can't invest in any company that's involved in liquor, alcoholic beverages. No Budweiser. You go right on down the line here. Now what they have is they have Sharia advisory boards so that these companies now in the United States of America are going to submit the operations of this company to the Sharia advisory board to have them issue an opinion as to whether they meet Sharia compliance. And then they'll sign off on it. And they get paid very handsomely for doing that. This is our buddy, Mufti Taqi Usmani. I'm sure he's got a good dental plan for his tooth.
Thanks, man.
This is the guy who wrote this. And if you read this, it will tell you precisely what the Muslims intend to do to us in America. This guy is over there in Pakistan. This is a very interesting character.
Is he Caucasian?
Pardon me? No. No, he actually was born in Pakistan. He sits on the Pakistan Supreme Court, and he sits on the Sharia board of roughly 16 companies that do business in the United States, and each one pays him $50,000 apiece. Now, for about $750,000, you probably can live pretty well in Pakistan. Taqi Usmani, he was a delegate to the Taliban in 2001 by the Pakistan Secret Service. They sent him over there. When we asked the Taliban to give us Osama bin Laden, Pakistan sent Taqi Usmani over to Afghanistan. I'm sorry, to go to Afghanistan and convince the Taliban not to give him up. And he was the chairman of our Dow Jones Advisory Board. He runs a website out of Garden Grove, California, called Al-Balagh. You can get all kinds of jihadist literature out of there. You can buy this. He'll even give you an autographed copy of this. Former Dow Jones Islamic Fund Sharia Board Chairman, Guidance Financial Group, Guidance Residential. I want you to remember that. He was also the chairman of the Citibank, Citigroup, investment bank in Bahrain. Sits on 16 Islamic Sharia boards, 50,000 of each. I want you to remember this, our capita. We're going to go to ourcapita.com. That's pretty cool. It used to be called Crescent Capital, but they thought that was too Islamic, so they changed it to our capita, which stands for Arab capital. Okay? All kinds of interesting stuff. He also assisted Zia-ul-Haq. You remember the movie Charlie Wilson's War? You remember Zia-ul-Haq? He was the guy who, the general who took over Pakistan after he killed Bhutto. And Zia-ul-Haq decided he was going to Islamicize Pakistan. Sharia law in Pakistan, that's where it all started. And he calls on Taqi Usmani to come on over there and help him do it. Here's his book, Islam and Modernism. Right there, it's on our website in PDF. He wrote this book about 30 years ago, and his opinions he keeps reaffirming even today. This is what he says in the book. Quote, jihad is obligatory against hostile, non-compromising, non-Muslim states if Muslims have the power to carry it out so that our force is broken and we do not obstruct the preaching of Islam. Remember I told you what happens when a Muslim goes from Dar al-Islam to Dar al-Harb and he comes to you and he goes, Jack, I'd like you to convert. I want you to listen to how I pitch you Islam, and you say, get the heck out of here, not interested. And I go, oh, you're hostile now. I have the right to go after you so that you do not obstruct the preaching of Islam, because he's liable to go next door and tell the guy next door, hey, there's some schnook coming down here. He's going to try and tell you to convert. Well, I can't allow that to happen. So that's the defense mechanism involved.
Muslims must attain their martial superiority and keep expanding it so that non-Muslim states remain subdued for fear of jihad, to say nothing of actual jihad. Think of Iran and the bomb. That's exactly what's going on. The purpose of jizya, that's that extortion tax that's collected by Ahmed now instead of Guido on Friday. The purpose of jizya is to give the infidels a chance for a time during which the infidels may hopefully get convinced of the truth of Islam and embrace it. So in other words, you're not going to pay protection forever. At some point they're going to say, you know, we're done screwing around with you and we're going to take you out. My humble self is of the view that the purpose of jihad aims at breaking the grandeur of unbelievers and establish that of Muslims. This guy's running around right now and he's talking about this. Guy's 80 years old. Aggressive jihad is lawful even today for the purpose it was lawful in those days for establishing the grandeur of the religion of Allah. Now I love this. This is the usual suspects. These are the top six Sharia advisory board guys in the world. Here you got Taki Usmani over here. Okay? Then you have this guy, nice grandfather-looking character in the back, Sheikh Yusuf De Lorenzo.
American.
De Lorenzo? Wait a minute. That's not Arabic. That's Italian. Well, it turns out that our friend De Lorenzo here happened to be the son of Sicilian immigrants who came to Massachusetts, and he's an American citizen. He was born in Massachusetts. He had to kind of leave town here last year, and now he's living in Dubai. And again, he lives in Dubai very nicely. He makes $50,000 a year off these Sharia advisory boards. But you got to know who this guy is. You ready for blood to come out of your eyes? Sheikh Talal De Lorenzo. He assisted Zia ul Haq. Zia ul Haq asked him to come over there together with Taki Usmani from 1981 to 1984, and he created the Taliban, who we are fighting in Afghanistan. So here you have this guy who has been with the Muslim Brotherhood and the Muslim Students Association. He was the go-to guy several years ago when we were going into Iraq, who set up the Muslim chaplain program. Here's the guy who created the Taliban. It gets better. Gets better. Again, tip of the iceberg. In 2004, you ready? It's going to be a bumpy ride. The Treasury issued a press release appearing on the Treasury's website. You can still find it. It's on there. You got to dig for it now. The U.S. government places significant importance on promoting Islamic finance. That's a complete violation of the First Amendment. Total violation of the First Amendment. This guy right here, 2 years ago, decides he's going to file a lawsuit against our friend Tim Geithner. Now, here's another trivia thing here for you Jeopardy guys. Tim Geithner's father is a guy named Peter Franz Geithner. Guy's 82 years old, he's still alive. Peter Franz Geithner spent 28 years working for the Ford Foundation. He was the direct supervisor of the grant that was given to Obama's mother to go study in Indonesia. Remember Yasser Arafat and his uncle, Haji Amin al-Husseini, the Nazi? Okay, this is what we're dealing with here. This is this whole nexus. This is this cabal of all of these people who know each other. And we're sitting here, fat, dumb, and happy, and we don't know because they're saying, never mind your lying eyes, do what I tell you. Okay, so here's the case. The case was filed up in Utah, and a federal judge finally threw it out. He was told to throw it out. Now what happened was, well, I'll get there in a minute. Okay, I got to get to this, because this is terrific. Okay, this is the front cover of the seminar that was given on November 6th. That was a couple days after the election in 2008, wasn't it? 2008, in association with the Department of the Treasury and Harvard Law School, the Islamic Finance Project. It was a seminar at our United States Treasury, kind of like the White House, we own it, right? And it was entitled Islamic Finance 101. It was sponsored by Harvard Law School, the Islamic Studies program there, and the United States Treasury to acquaint people in the investment community with Islamic finance. What is this all about? Okay, 2008, everything was going down the tank, right? Whole economic situation was tanking and everything, and people were losing money. Your 401ks were going down the toilet. So, follow the money. Now, what's interesting is that the keynote speaker was Yusuf Talal De Lorenzo. The guy who created the Taliban was the keynote speaker on November 6th at our Treasury Department, sponsored by Harvard Law School. I had a problem with that. It's kind of like Keith Ellison taking his oath of office on a copy of the Quran. Well, wait a minute. This gets even better. 2008, right after the election, who was the president of Harvard Law School?
Kagan.
Elena Kagan. Now it gets better. Turns out that about 5 years before, around 2003, this guy who is the nephew of the king of Saudi Arabia, Al-Walid bin Talal, gave $20 million to Elena Kagan at Harvard Law School to set up the bin Talal Islamic Studies program. He also gave $20 million to John Esposito at Georgetown University to set up the bin Talal Islamic Studies program. So Kagan, and let's see, who was the president of Harvard in November of 2008? Let me think. Larry Summers. He took the money. They both took the money. So Obama gets elected. And what happened to Summers and Kagan right after the election? Larry Summers became the chairman of the Council of Economic Advisors, and Elena Kagan became the Solicitor General in the White House. Can you say payback? Now, what's even more interesting is that Obama is a personal friend of Al-Walid bin Talal. And it's the Saudis and bin Talal and his brother and a guy named Mansour, Khalid Mansour, who financed Obama's education through Columbia and Harvard Law. And if you want to see that research, go on my website and scroll down there and you will find Obama's Middle East connection. This is why Obama accepted that high gold chain award from the king of Saudi Arabia, and why he bowed so low to this guy. And then you wonder why he stopped the oil drilling in the United States on federal land off both coasts, the Gulf of Mexico and Anwar, to increase by 20% the oil we're buying from the Saudis. Connect the dots. Nothing happens in a vacuum. Connect the dots. Kagan. Now, I'm curious why all of our lovely Republicans on the Judiciary Committee that had to vote to confirm her as a justice on the Supreme Court didn't ask her about this. Kagan, you took the money. This was payoff. This was pay for play. You took the money, you sponsored the Islamic thing. You got to be Solicitor General, and then that catapulted you into being a justice on the Supreme Court. What's really cool is if you go on my other website called ObamaThreat.com, you will find under theses, I'm going to call it feces, you will find Elena Kagan's Princeton senior thesis on the benefits of socialism. You will find Hillary Clinton's thesis on the benefits of Saul Alinsky, which is a whole different lecture. That's what we did for the Marin Conservative Forum and then down in Fresno for 300 people. You can't make this stuff up. You got to read this stuff. You remember how Obama decided he could do all this stuff by executive order?
You're getting off track.
Well, then take a look on that website also for Cass Sunstein's Harvard Law School thesis. That's where Obama got the idea, and now you just discovered that Cass Sunstein has resigned from Obama's. Okay? So let's talk about a couple of these financial issues. Our capita. Pardon me?
What did Jesus say?
I said that Cass Sunstein just resigned from Obama's cabinet.
Really?
This week?
Last week. You didn't read that?
I missed it.
Cass Sunstein just resigned. He went back to teaching at Harvard Law School. Except his wife, Samantha Power, that's a whole different issue, and she's alive and well, and she should be in prison for the next 100 years. Our capita, okay? This is taken right off their website, ourcapita.com, arabcapital.com, the Bank of Bahrain. This is what the Muslims own. Have you ever gone down the street and seen a pods container? You know pods, they put it in your driveway and you put all this stuff in there and then you call a truck, you come store it. Muslims own pods. You just keep on going down here. Cirrus Design Corporation, Caribou Coffee.
What about the coffee maker? What is it?
Keurig? No, Keurig just uses Caribou Coffee. They're in everything. They are in everything. Our capital, through the Bank of Bahrain, you got to love this, is the largest stockholder in senior citizen retirement homes in America.
Wow.
That's all our petrodollars coming back. Corporate information. This is right off of our capital's website. Took a screenshot. They operate at 4 offices in Bahrain, Atlanta, London, and Singapore. On and on and on. They have a balance sheet footing of $3.6 billion equity capital, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
Follow the money.
Guess who's on their Sharia advisory board? You can't make this stuff up. It's right on their website. Here's a guy who is prohibited from entering the United States for terrorist financing, who lives in Pakistan, and he's on the advisory board for a Capita Corporation out of Atlanta. Caribou Coffee. Here's their NASDAQ symbol. www.cariboucoffee.com. Here are their partners in Caribou Coffee, owned by the Muslims. Frontier Airlines, Kemp's, Keurig. Keurig uses Caribou Coffee. They throw it in there. Minnesota Vikings. Maybe that's why they didn't do so well last year. U.S. Useless Today.
USA Today.
Just go on the website. Caribou Coffee, headquartered in Minneapolis. They have 500 company-owned locations. There's 70 in the Middle East. You remember Zakat? 2.5% of all the profits from those 70 in the Middle East go to fund terrorism. They're skimmed off the top, 2.5%, and they go through these guys like Usmani, who then portions that money out, and some of it goes to Jihad. Who owns Caribou? They're very proud of this. It's right on their website. Our majority stockholder since 2000 is an affiliate of our Capital Bank in Bahrain. Now, you're going to love this. AIG. Is there anybody in here who doesn't know who AIG is? American Insurance Group, too big to fail. Okay? We gave them $182 billion to bail them out. We own essentially close to 80%. $40 billion out of that $182 went to their Sharia subsidiary in Dubai. Let me tell you what happened. Back there in 2006, 2007, if you remember, oil started to go up. It was selling for about $40 a barrel. It ultimately went up to $147 a barrel, and all the oil speculators thought it was going higher. So what they did was they went to the oil brokers in the Middle East, and they said, we want to buy oil. We want to buy oil futures. So these brokers turned around, they said, okay, give me your $100,000, we'll guarantee you $150,000 in 24 months. Because everybody thought it was going up. Well, what happened to oil?
It went to 147, took a dive, came back down to about 70, 80 a couple of years ago. We were paying $1.86 for gas. Now we're paying $4 again. So what happened? Well, the oil brokers went to AIG and insured the oil contracts. So when the oil went back down, and now 2 years later, they got to give you, you gave them $100,000, now they guaranteed you $150,000. They insured that with AIG. They're broke. You go to AIG, turn your oil contract in, and says, you got to pay me. That's why we taxpayers had to send $40 billion of our tax money to AIG's Middle East subsidiary to cover all of these oil contracts that went in the toilet.
This is so overwhelming. Are you going to tell us that when the election comes, that if Romney gets in, that we are going to see any difference at all in our government?
No, we better.
So you're saying, thank God you're giving me a little hope there.
Actually, no, I have less hope. Because my concern is with all this money and all this going on, he's going to be walking right back in that White House.
Yep.
Okay.
If we're talking about all this infiltration and all this money, then and our Congress is, knows this about Kagan and everything else, nothing's happening, he's going to be walking right.
Can I leave you some, with some hope?
Oh, okay. Please.
I certainly hope so.
Have you seen the movie?
All right. AIG. AIG now for the last several years has been involved because of the Muslim financial investment in our economy, which is over $1 trillion, they've decided now that getting into the Muslim mortgage business would be a good idea. They can't call it insurance, so they call it shared risk. Like, Allah doesn't know this. We're going to fool Allah. We can't charge interest. So we're going to call it shared risk, and he won't know this, okay? An Islamic financial certificate. It's called a financial certificate. It's similar to a bond. The issuer makes a contractual promise to buy back the certificate at a future date at par value plus profit. Not interest, because under Islam you're allowed to make profit. Not interest. And then the issuer of the bond turns around and insures it through AIG. So AIG found a whole other money stream. We bailed them out, so they're back in business. The asset securing the certificate is worth less than the par value plus the profit fee at maturity. The issuer can't pay it. The issuer submits the bond to AIG and AIG pays it, and then they come to us, the taxpayers, to get them bailed out again. It's kind of like Fannie and Freddie. Again, we own 79.9% of AIG. They're now involved in homeowners insurance, but we can't call it homeowners insurance. We got to call it shared risk. Because again, Allah, we got to fool him. This is right off of AIG's website. You can't make this stuff up. Now they're insuring residential property sold to Muslims with Sharia compliant mortgages through Sharia compliant banks. Okay? Terminologies. Again, 2.5% has to be donated to Islamic charities. You're talking about a ton of money here. A lot of money. And then you wonder where, you know, Hamas and Al-Qaeda are getting their money from. 2.5% of the profits. These are only projections here. Lots of money. Remember these guys? The usual suspects? Remember I told you, remember Guidance Financial Group. Taki Usmani, involved with Guidance Financial Group. Guidance Residential, they make Muslim residential loans. You're going to love this. Guidance Residential launches innovative Islamic securities program to Middle East United Arab Emirates. Tuesday, March 9, 2004. Look at this. This is how long it's been going on. The fund will hold securities that are backed by Sharia-compliant real estate finance assets in America. The securities will be issued and guaranteed by the Federal Home Loan Mortgage Corporation. That's Freddie Mac. $5
Follow the money. That's Freddie Mac, Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac. Okay? That's our money. They keep coming to us every couple of months for another $70 billion bailout. Guidance Residential Mortgage. As an independent body, this is right off the website, the Sharia Supervisory Board of Guidance Residential includes Sharia scholars who are among the world's leading experts in the Islamic law of financial transactions, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Who are they? Oh, look at this. Guidance Residential, Taki Usmani and Talal De Lorenzo. Usmani lives in Pakistan, De Lorenzo lives in Dubai. And these companies turn around, they write these residential mortgages for Muslims, 2.5% of the profit off that mortgage comes off the top and it gets sent to these guys without having to tell anybody in the United States, send that money wherever they want to in the Middle East. You gotta love this one. Greetings from the Sharia Supervisory Board. Muslims across North America, managing their money, managing closing. I wish you a pleasant experience in all your transactions with guidance. Sincerely, Yusuf Talal De Lorenzo, the guy who created the Taliban. Here's the difference between the mortgages. Remember, you can't charge interest in Islam. So what happens is, if you go to get a mortgage, conventional mortgage, we do. We go in the bank and we say, okay, we're buying a $200,000 house. Actually, they're selling for $200,000 these days. We're buying a $200,000 house. I've got $100,000 to put down. No problem. You rent a mortgage for $100,000, payable over 30 years, whatever it is, for 100 grand, 300 and some odd dollars a month, and principal and interest. Okay? You get the deed. Anybody here in the mortgage business or anything? Real estate agent? Okay, when you buy the home and it goes through escrow, whose name is on the grant deed? Not the trust deed, but the grant deed.
The bank.
Who's the owner? No. That's the trust deed. The grant deed is the buyer.
It's the grant from the seller to the buyer.
Correct. The buyer's name. Okay. Correct. This is not the promissory note. This is not the trust deed. The trust deed now is between the buyer and the bank for that $100,000 loan. Well, they don't do that here with a Sharia compliant mortgage because you can't charge interest. So what they do is they call it shared ownership. So if you're a Muslim, you walk into a bank that deals with Sharia compliant mortgages and you say, okay, I want to buy a $200,000 house. I got $100,000 to put down. They say, that's not a problem. Okay? Because now what happens is you're going to be shared ownership. When you get that deed, the bank and the buyer are on that grant deed as tenants in common as to an undivided interest of 50% each. So the bank owns 50, you own 50, and now the bank says, well, you want to finance this for 30 years, we're entitled to make $12,000 profit, so your obligation is $112,000 if you continue to pay it for 30 years. Now, you can pay it off early, you get a break on the profit, not the interest, it's profit, okay? Because the bank's entitled to make profit. So as you pay off the loan, the interest that you own as the buyer rises and the bank's interest goes down. Now, what's really cool about that is, let's say you decide to default on the mortgage, you get up and walk away, the bank is on that deed. The bank can now take over the property, no foreclosure involved. Okay? So how does Sharia finance fund terrorism? Through zakat. We're back to zakat. The five pillars of Islam. Allah is the one God, Muhammad's his prophet. Muslims pray five times a day. Muslims must pay zakat. Cannot be paid to a non-Muslim. And it funds jihad. Eight categories of zakat. Number 7, Muslims engaged in jihad. Everything's right here in these books. Every Muslim is required to donate annually at least 2.5% of their wealth, including assets, trade goods, and investments to Islamic charities, and includes all Sharia-compliant businesses, including all those banks. If you write a Sharia-compliant loan, then 2.5% of whatever you make on that loan, you're going to have to give it to them. Remember these guys? This is the prospectus for the investment that doesn't comply with the SEC. 2.5% of the profits to Middle East charities that go through Sharia advisory boards, but they don't tell you that in the investment prospectus. All it says is that this is subject to Sharia law. You want to know what the risks are? Go find them. You get your statement. If you have one of these funds, you make money on it, you get your statement closing that fund out, and there's a miscellaneous charge of 2.5%.
Question on 2.5%. Who monitors that of the Muslim? The imam, or who's the hierarchy?
The Sharia advisory board.
Of every Muslim group in the United States, they're overseeing those people giving 2.5%?
That's correct. It's a lot of money. That's a lot of money. They have over $1 trillion invested in our stock market.
How have they done Dow? How is the Dow index, Islamic index, done this year?
They're doing all right.
They did?
Yeah, they're doing all right.
Before?
No, they're creeping up. They're not volatile. They're not as volatile as some of the other speculative stuff.
So is that why anybody who could even possibly do something, whether it be in Congress or anybody, to point a finger and start something, because it would actually be the total downfall of our financial system? Is that why people are tight-mouthed and not saying anything or doing anything, or they're pointing out about Elaine Kagan and this? Because of all the money in the U.S.
Oh, yeah,
that
sure.
Totally destroy the finances. I mean, literally.
It's so ingrained.
That's right. You can't.
It's so ingrained. How do you deconstruct it?
Yeah.
How do you deconstruct it? When you have the Treasury that's sponsoring it, how do you deconstruct it?
So there's no way out from this aspect.
Not without a whole lot of pain.
You could ban the investment.
I'm just a messenger. I just need to educate you as to what's going on.
Do you do this part to like financial planners, advisors?
Do I what?
Do you do this piece? Would you do this piece to financial planners?
Oh, absolutely. Because I would love to have anybody here who's got a 401k or a 403b or a brokerage account or something like that. You've got a stock portfolio. Maybe you ought to take a look and see what's in it.
They
know nothing of this.
No, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Speak to them.
Oh, I would love to. I would love to.
Show them those two books underneath the green Quran over there.
Oh, the Sharia for non-Muslims.
Those are really good.
Yeah, these are also on my website. All of this financial stuff is in this book under Financial Jihad on the website, on the sidebar. And then you also have this book, and you can download it. You don't have to pay for it. Sharia Law for Non-Muslims. It's an excellent book.
Your stockbroker should know about that.
Yeah.
Should read it.
Especially the finance one.
Yeah.
How about Vanguard?
Oh, I'm invested in Vanguard.
I didn't add Cheetah.
No, Vanguard.
Okay.
You don't worry about Vanguard.
So there is a way to still have your money working for you and not have it contribute to
it. Oh, yeah. Oh, absolutely. Okay. Absolutely. If somebody's going to put you into an investment, read the prospectus, read the risk paragraph. If it says this is a Sharia compliant investment, run. Okay? Because in essence, you could be funding terrorism. It's that simple.
It's almost 3:00. We've got to.
All right. We're out of here in a minute. They don't have to disclose. That's what I just said. No, that's what that is.
And that's that. Questions?
First of all,
if you guys will go out and tell three or four or five people what you heard today, send them to the website, let them read it for themselves, I will have done my job. Again, I wish this guy had still been here. That was good.
Yeah.
I'm surprised nobody accused me of engineering that.
Incidentally, I gave him the money earlier.
Oh, okay. You gave him his check? Okay.
I don't remember that. It was actually Greg Abdul.
I don't know who it was. I'm glad he showed up, though, because it absolutely exemplifies the problem.
Yeah.
Did you read the book? No, but that's hate speech. No, you got to read the book. You got to read the book. It's coming from there, not from here. Ma'am.
You said you'd give us some hope.
Right. Oh, yeah, we're ready for that.
You have the bad news, where's the good news?
Knowledge is power. Knowledge is power. I think now you have some of the tools that you need to go and talk to the city council on what you're trying to do here, especially with these textbooks. You can ask very, very pointed questions. Well, what textbooks do you plan on using? Can you tell us what those textbooks are? Okay, is this going to be a full-time school, part-time school? How are you getting around the California laws about burial? Okay, you guys want to have a cemetery. Is it going to be an Islamic-run cemetery? We have the whole procedure for Islamic burial that's on our website for the Bay Area. Are you going to adhere to this? Go to the Quran.
Take in your own Quran with you so you know.
Now nobody can BS you. You know where to find the information. And now you guys have to community organize. Okay?
This might be a small point, but it's interesting to me. We, as Patriots, had an event where we were filmed by the BBC as a group, as a Tea Party group in Morgan Hill, and they were interviewing me anyway. There was a guy there in the full robes and the skull cap and everything to incite, I don't know, but it didn't work. The interesting thing was I walked up to him and I said, "Hi, how are you? My name is Caroline." And he said, I can't touch you. I'm sorry, I can't touch you. And this is what is coming to America. He wouldn't touch women. I can't touch women.
Where's Robin? Where'd Robin go? He's got a story about that from Saudi Arabia, where when he was flying for the UN in Saudi Arabia, and he got out on the highway, and there was some woman in a Mercedes, black Mercedes, and she was driving like a bat out of hell doing 150 miles an hour. Cops were right there. Cops didn't stop her because they can't involve themselves with dealing with women. Now, there are a few women who are allowed to drive themselves in Saudi Arabia. Yeah, not many. I mean, they're related to the princes. There's 4,000 princes.
You talked about the unholy alliance of the liberals with the Islamists.
Mm-hmm.
When are the Jewish people going to wake up?
Oh, boy.
Yes.
I got to tell you something. That is a question that I am asked, pardon the pun, religiously. Okay?
When are Jews going to wake up?
I have to describe myself as a Warsaw Ghetto Jew. If you don't understand what that means, go look up the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising during... I'm sorry?
I'm 100% Russian Jew.
There you go. As long as you're not a Bolshevik.
She wouldn't be here.
I accept the fact that you're here. But this is very interesting that you bring that up, because this is the people who are running the government today. David Axelrod, descendant of Russian Bolsheviks. Bloomberg, descendant, son of Russian Bolsheviks, who came over here after the Russian Revolution, 1917. If you go back and you take a look on Google the Red Scare. The Red Scare in 1920. The Red Scare were Jewish Bolsheviks
And what's interesting was Stalin was married four times and three of his wives were Jewish.
Could we talk about why are police out there?
Go look up the Red Scare. The Red Scare were Jewish Bolsheviks who started the Russian Revolution in 1917 and then had to escape Russia when Stalin took over because he was trying to purge them. They were true believers. They came over here and they tried to overthrow the United States government in 1920. Go look up the Red Scare. It's a very interesting piece of history. For the simple reason that the ACLU was created back then to defend them against the Department of Justice. And if you go on my which website is it on? God, I don't even remember now. I have several commentaries because nobody is more anti-Semitic than I am against liberal Jews because they're suicidal. They care more about their liberalism than they do about preserving Israel. They are liberal because there is a neurosis that has genetically inhabited their psyche over 3,000 years of persecution. Jews hate authority. I have a corollary, unless they are the authority. And I have written extensively on this, and it just, I can't even begin to tell you. I cannot do this in a Jewish congregation. I cannot talk to rabbis. We've tried. It's a physical impossibility because they don't want to hear. I have several commentaries that I wrote of the neurosis of the American Jew, the roots of my anti-Semitism. It makes me crazy because they don't understand what they're doing. And the majority are all descendants of Russian Bolsheviks. They are true believers. They are true believers in liberalism, not Judaism. It's like this man who called himself a Sikh, but he's never read anything. It's like a Muslim who says, no, I'm a Muslim. Have you ever read the book? No. So you've got a Jewish community, a liberal Jewish community out there who is trying to assimilate. They don't want to be pointed at. That's why they hate Israel, because Israel is the pebble in the Islamic shoe. And so now you see all these problems with Hamas and the PLO, and will there ever be peace over there between Israel and the West Bank? And of course not. Of course not. That will never happen. And the problem with Jews today is that they're trying in America very hard to not look as though they're different. We want to be just like you. And what fascinates the hell out of me is that the majority of all my friends are all Christian. They all support Israel. They all support Israel more than the liberal Jews do in America. Because people go, oh, Palestine, yeah, look what you're doing to the poor Palestinians. You're Jewish. Okay. And they make this nexus. So they're perfectly willing to let Israel be destroyed in order to feed their neurosis over here with the lack of assimilation. And it's crazy. It's just, it's crazy. All I got to do is go and read Revelations.
That's right. We win in the end, amen. Hallelujah.
I asked my question earlier on. If Islam is not a religion, what do you say it is?
It's a cult.
Islam is an ideology for world domination. There, I find no difference, thank God this guy's not sitting here now, but I find no difference between the Quran and Mein Kampf.
Yeah.
Do you know what the second most widely read book is in the Middle East? Mein Kampf.
What is it?
Mein Kampf, Hitler's Manifesto. Mein Kampf. I have a copy at home in Arabic. It is the second most widely read book in the Middle East, next to the Quran.
Do you read Arabic?
Do I read Arabic?
Yeah.
A little bit.
Okay.
It's very much like Hebrew, and I used to read and speak Hebrew and teach Hebrew many years ago, and it's all read from right to left, like all of the other, you know, Aramaic languages and stuff like that. But hopefully I'm not going to be forced to do it.
Yeah. But the train has left the station.
We got to derail the train.
Amen. But how can we do that if we can't go to our leaders? The financiers have it all sewed up, it seems.
They don't own all the money.
This is what Chief Justice Roberts, we were talking about this. This is what Chief Justice Roberts was trying to tell everybody with the Obamacare ruling. It's not up to the Supreme Court to save us. It's up to us. We get the leaders we elect. We get the government that we elect.
But once they get in there, once they smell, they breathe that air or drink that water, they start to get right in with
the term limits.
Exactly.
Term limits. Joe Biden. Joe Biden has been in Congress for 40 some odd years.
Stupid.
Well, look at Bright Eyes Pelosi.
And all of them have gotten rich just being congressmen.
50% of congresspeople.
Because they can do things we can't.
They pass laws. They pass laws that they don't subject themselves to. Okay? I want their health care system. I want the health care system that kept Ted Kennedy alive with a brain tumor for a year and a half. Or Nancy Pelosi. That's the health care system I want. Let them be subject to this nonsense that they pass. Anyway.
Do you see hope?
Or do you think
that
we're going to hope?
I see hope. You know the hope that I see? The combination of Mitt Romney, who is a big picture guy, who's been there, done it. Okay, fixed the Olympics, the only Olympics ever made a profit, fired all those people on the take, got rid of them, turned the whole thing around. The guy knows how to do it. And you got the detailed guy now, Paul Ryan, who is absolutely the smartest guy in the federal budget in the United States today. So you got the big picture guy, you got the detailed guy, and I think finally we got a couple of good Boy Scouts.
Do you have the faith, though, that this can be done fairly? Without this and the finances behind Obama.
Because Obama just passed amnesty for how many?
That's backfiring on him.
Yeah, that's
the black community is furious with him.
The number one thing that you have to remember is Romney was able to just see Obamacare is going to be the biggest thing. Medicare is going to be the biggest problem for getting election. I mean, they're going to use that against the Republicans like crazy. Yes. He took the head of the stake and he said, here it is. I'm choosing this guy as my running mate. And the fact that he did that gave me hope that we may win this.
But the bottom line is the election process itself. I know everything and everything.
It's corrupt.
That's exactly what I'm saying. Do you really have faith? That with all this and hearing all this now,
it's up to us. We have to keep on everybody.
But how many people know everybody?
That's up to us.
You come back and do another lecture. Sure.
That's why you're active.
How many people come back and do another lecture, knock on doors,
poll watch, do whatever it takes.
You come back and do another lecture that's called Winning Elections. That'll get more people here that aren't afraid of the whole Islamic thing.
Does he talk about the Black Panthers? Excuse me.
No.
That's important.
Well, yeah, he talks a little bit about it. You'll come back and see changes
in your city councils in Dublin, Walnut Creek, Concord.
Little bit by little bit.
Campaign
it's
manager.
Little bit it's by little bit.
But this election, 3 months, it's literally
judicial. You have no idea how many nights I have.
Okay, you guys, let's stay here.